PG&E intended to build a nuclear power plant right here, a reactor. And the big dream, developers were already thinking there'd be a freeway from here to San Francisco along the coast. Local activists got wind of the story. Now, the way it works is the same old story. They go through the courts, they get the permissions, they got a public relations branch, and they were steamrolling this through with politicians who were making decisions without really public comment. So the activists banded together and started a campaign to make the public comment. And some fortuitous things happened. There were Malvina Reynolds, I don't know if you remember Little Boxes, Little Boxes. She wrote a song against the reactor. Okay, that got traction. The editor of the Chronicle was on vacation, and the assistant editor got a big story in about the danger. So that got a lot of press. They did demonstrations here where they had balloons, helium balloons, with strontium written on it. They released them. They float south. They lose the helium and drop in your backyard, and you read, "You're holding strontium from the Bodega Bay power plant." So the consciousness went, and this was early 60s, so there was a sense of resistance. But the final blow was a UC geologist came out, climbed into the hole, said, "You're on the San Andreas Fault. Bad idea." Yeah. And I believe at that point the AEC backed out and PG&E said, washed their hands of it. So this hole would have been the foundation of a
we would, Bodega Bay would have been a nice warm place to swim then, right?
Yeah. Well, that was one of the arguments. There was a lot of people who said it's going to warm up the water and kill the fish.
Yeah.
We live on that fish.
Well, I guess it was a case of citizen activists expressing concerns that delayed it long enough
for consciousness
to actually be able to pay attention to what issues might have actually happened. If something like that had happened in Japan, for instance, people might have, you know, put higher seawalls up at least or something like that.
You do need the citizen involvement to build a kind of a momentum.
Yeah, and as we think about how to deal with global warming and all of that, we have to be really thoughtful, especially with nuclear, because the isotopes are so long-lived, and the storage and isolation issues are so big. We have to think. You talked about seven generations. If we just thought seven generations, but I've been arguing for a while that seven generations isn't enough anymore. You know, if you're dealing with, you know, plutonium, 24,000-year half-life. So you really have to plan a lot farther ahead.
Something we can't do, you know, 24,000 years.
No, so you have to build something into it, something into the system, the political system, to make sure it's going to be properly stewarded.
Well, there's the scientific information, there's the political system, but there's also consciousness, people's perceptions, your grandchildren. Imagine that they're there with us now, right here. And we're making decisions that are going to affect them. If people could live like that, we'd make different decisions. So maybe this is the wake-up call to start thinking like that. Anyway, that's my dream. I'm not a scientist.
I like that. I like that.
Fish all die and the lakes catch fire, will it be worth it then? And when the cancer rates 90% or higher, will it be worth it then? When the whole world's at war over water and oil, will it be worth it then? And when there's no more fighting, 'cause there's no more spoils, will it be worth it then? If not, what will it take to make you change your mind? What kind of sign convince you that people are worth more than you can from them? What has to happen before Convince you that people are worth more than you.